All right, welcome back. As we go back into dealing with supply and demand, we're going to start talking about price ceilings and price floors. Let's start with a price ceiling. So what happens when you try to stop prices from getting too high? So suppose supply and demand, where they intersect, where the equilibrium price is too high for you or too high for your society. Like suppose you live in New York City and you're trying to rent an apartment and there's just not that many apartments available, so the price of apartments out there, rent is extremely high. What do you do? Well, you either have to pay the high price or the government steps in and says, we're not gonna allow the price of apartments in New York to get over this line. If you charge more than this, you're breaking the law and you can be sued, basically. What does that do to the market? Does that fix the market? No. What it really does is it forces there to be what? Well, if this is the price, what's going on? Here's where this price, this is how much we're gonna supply at that price. This is how much we're gonna demand. We're gonna demand way more than the supply. So what does a price ceiling do for us? It leads us into a case where we have a shortage. Generally speaking, price ceilings create shortages. Do realize that if you put the price ceiling above the equilibrium price, somewhere up here, say, note that this ceiling does nothing because the equilibrium price is actually below it. That's one of those trick type of questions that might be asked, right? If someone said that the ceiling was up here, how has it affected supply and demand? In this case, it would be, it does nothing. But for us, with our ceiling right here below the equilibrium price, this is forcing a shortage because more people are going to demand apartments in New York than there are available to them. And what does that lead to, generally speaking, when you have a shortage? Well, it usually means that the price is going to go up because that's what a shortage means. But here, we're not allowing the price to go up. We're forcing it to stay low. So what you end up winding up with is illegal transactions, people renting houses without being, you know, following the rules, without being a part of a renters association, lots of other things that shouldn't be occurring if you just let the market take over. All right? So what about a price floor? A price floor is the opposite, but still the same to some degree. Here, this would be our equilibrium, and now we're going to say, oh, well, we want to force our price to be up here. This is the floor. Why would you set a floor up here? You'd be protecting your markets. So suppose, if you will, you're in the dairy industry, and the dairy industry is tanking in the United States. For whatever reason, the price of milk and cheese has gone so far down that we don't have a way of keeping the small farms open. So what the government steps in and does is says, we will pay for any dairy products at least this particular price. The market would say you should pay, $2 for a gallon of milk, and the government comes in and says, we'll always pay you at least $2.50. What happens there? Well, now, at that price, this is what we would demand. This would be our quantity demanded. This is how much is supplied. What happens here? Surplus. Generally speaking, floors, price floors, force surpluses. They force us to make more than is reasonable, right? We should produce roughly this much. But since the government's going to pay us at a rate that's way over what, say a regular grocery store might pay us, we're going to go ahead and produce way more milk than we should, or way more chunks of cheese than we would normally, because we can always guarantee that the government's going to buy them. All right? Those folks are what happens with price floors and price ceilings.